Okay. Let's get started with our discussion on dynamic optimization. Dynamic optimization problem. So the state space equation for the system is given by xt plus 1 equals to ft, the function of the current state and the action that is taken. So this is the state, this is state, this is action, and ft is known to, is called the state transition function, state transition function. Okay. We have a performance index, a cost function j of u 0. So t goes from 0 to capital T minus 1. So u 0 to u t minus 1. G capital T x t plus summation t equals 0 to t minus 1 g small t x t u t. So this is known as terminal cost. This is known as running cost. Okay, this is all a recap of what we did in the previous class. And then there are two notions of optimality that we can talk about. So the first is we want optimal actions. U0 star, U capital T minus 1 star. And the other one is optimal policy, which is, let's say, gamma T star that maps XT to UT. Okay, and we are currently talking about computing the optimal actions. And we will be talking about maximum principle today, maximum principle or minimum principle today. So that will give us optimal actions. And we'll talk about optimal policy when we talk about dynamic programming, perhaps in the next class. Okay. All right. So one of the simplifications we made yesterday, we were considering the case when g sub t is equal to 0. So we only have a terminal cost, so j of u. I'm just going to write this collection as a vector u. So u is equal to g capital T, x capital T. Okay, so we only have a terminal cost, we don't have a running cost in this particular system or in this particular case. And the other thing we talked about was that xt can be written as a function of u, but phi t only uses only u naught to ut minus 1. Okay. Any questions so far? This is all a recap of the previous class. Yes.
So is that saying that the actions at the current, or I'm sorry, the state at the current time step is a function of the actions at every time step?
Yes, until that time step.
Until that time step. Okay, yeah. So everything before.
Yeah, everything that happened before.
So that's not.
So it also is a function of x naught, which is the initial state. But that initial state is absorbed in this function phi t because that doesn't change from time to time. Initial state is initial state.
So that's not big T minus 1, that's little t minus 1.
That's little t minus 1, yeah. Even though I'm writing it as a function of the whole set, it's just a function of only the first t terms, small t terms, okay? All right, so based on this this equality, I can actually eliminate all xt from the objective function, and I can write j of u as g of t phi of t of u, right? And the goal is to minimize this over, let me just write it as u vector. In whatever space this u vector sits in.
So okay. You're choosing costs to choosing actions to minimize costs or minimize costs specifically at the end
yes.
of the observation time.
Yes. Yes.
Do we know the min exists? Or?
Assume that it does. I mean, throughout this course, we have always assumed that the min exists. Okay. Any other question? Yes.
So with the profit calculation model we covered in the last class, as would look at cost function and accounting for the time value of money, it go in the running cost there?
Time value of money.
Well, you have the buying power of
right.
any unit of currency changing due to
right.
to,
oh yeah, that would be part of the running cost. Okay. All right. So this is the formulation. So what's the necessary condition for optimality? So I started with a problem that was evolving over a state space. I had a bunch of actions that I need to take over time, and then what I did was I suppressed the entire. So by substituting variables. I basically suppressed the dynamic nature of the problem and I got a static optimization problem, okay? The static optimization problem is I want to minimize over all possible actions this big cost, okay? So GT composition phi T of this vector U, okay? So what would be a necessary condition for optimality? Any thoughts? Well, not you, someone else. Okay, what would be a necessary condition for optimality? So if U star is optimal, then what? Come on, someone should be able to give an answer. This is the third month in optimization. No one? Okay. Is that all? There's a first order necessary condition and then there is a second order. So the first order necessary condition is U star optimal implies what?
Derivative of J U.
Be equal to zero at U star.
Yeah.
Right? And the second order necessary condition for optimality is yeah. Well, I wouldn't say greater than zero. I will say positive definite. Or positive semi-definite. Okay? So I started with a dynamic problem. I did the substitution. Now I came up with a static problem. And then I can use all the results for static optimization problem here to to conclude the first order necessary condition and second order necessary condition for optimality. Okay? So now, what I'm going to do is, this expression is not very informative, okay? It's some long expression that we don't quite know what it looks like. So what I'm going to do is try to figure out a recursive equation to be able to compute this expression, the derivative of this function with respect to u. Okay, so that's the next goal. The question is, what is the expression of derivative with respect to u small t of this objective function? So let's do it for time. Let's do it for time t minus 1 first. So u t minus 1 of g t x t. That's given by u t minus 1 of g t of f t minus 1 x t minus 1 u t minus 1. Okay, so this is what I have. Now here is a formula that we did at the very beginning of this class, of this course. So I just want to recall it. So P1 composition P2 is a function from Rn to R. Then gradient of P1 composition P2 is gradient of P2 at x multiplied by gradient of P1 at P2 of x. Let me write it in a cleaner way. So P1 of y equals to P2 of x. Okay, that's chain rule. That's known as chain rule. Chain rule for differentiation. Okay, so everyone recalls this expression? Okay, we did that at the very beginning of this course.
So then by that, shouldn't it be the del ut minus 1 over all of gt? There needs to be some distributive argument there, because the actual answer would have a gradient of ft minus 1.
Yes, yes. So I'm going to apply the chain rule that I've written there in red. So what I have is gradient, well, I'll need more space, so I'm going to write it here. So I'll have gradient of ut minus 1, ft minus 1, multiplied by gradient of xt of gt. Okay, is that clear? All right. Let's do gradient of ut minus 2 gt of xt. Okay. Now, one thing to note here is that xt minus 1 actually doesn't depend on ut minus 1. Okay. So this is, so the derivative with respect to xt minus 1 is equal to 0. So I don't need to take into that the dependence. But here is another expression. So I'm not taking derivative with respect to ut minus 2. So I have derivative of ut minus 2 of gt of ft minus 1 of ft minus 2. Okay, so now I have like pretty long expression. So what would be the derivative here? So the derivative is gradient of ut minus 2 ft minus 2 multiplied by the derivative of xt minus 1 ft minus 1 multiplied by the derivative of gt with respect to xt. Okay, so I want you to stare at these expressions for some time. Okay, so let's stare at this expression for some time. What do we observe? We see a kind of a pattern here. So the last term is always the gradient with respect to gt. So gradient of gt with respect to xt. And then the first term is always the derivative of the action over which we are taking the derivative of the state transition function in which that action appears. So that's the same thing we see here. So ut minus 1, so derivative of ft minus 2 with respect to ut minus 2. And then we have a term here that bridges this term with this term, which is the derivative of ft minus 1 with respect to xt minus 1. So that's this term appearing in the middle. Okay. So first we see the derivative with respect to the innermost function. In the last, we have the derivative with respect to the outermost function. And in the middle, we have the derivative with respect to the function in the middle. Okay, so this expression would appear in all such derivatives in the same fashion. So let me write it. Okay, so we get such a long expression for derivative with respect to ut. You can use induction to prove it, or you can use repeated chain rule to prove the same result. Okay. Now let me try to introduce another variable that represents this big multiplication, and I'm going to call it PT plus 1, okay? And this will be called co-state vector. So what I get is I'm defining P capital T as gradient of GT. I'm defining P small t as gradient with respect to XT of FT multiplied by PT plus 1. And I have gradient of UT of G capital T, X capital T is given by okay. So once I fix x naught, so x naught is something that's given, x naught is the initial state that's given, then I come up with some sort of control actions u1, u2, u3, u0, u1, u2, u3, all the way up to u capital T minus 1. Okay, and that fixes the trajectory. The trajectory is the sequence of states that would appear in the system. Okay, so that, so once the initial state is given, and I pick a set of control actions, I get the entire trajectory. Now, I want to look at what the derivative of the final cost is with respect to the actions that I've picked up, that I've picked at various points of time. And we could see that this is what the derivative looks like in the long expression, and then we introduced a co-state vector in order to simplify the expression, and this is what we get.
Those actions aren't picked arbitrarily, right? They're picked as a result of some other kind of optimization.
So I'm assuming that you want to do the optimization of action. So you initially, just like in the case of gradient descent, you pick the initial point randomly. You are essentially picking the initial actions randomly.
Initial actions,
so u0, u1, u2, all the way up to u capital T minus 1.
Okay.
So when you're, okay, so here is how to think about it. When you were running gradient descent, you would not pick just x1, which is the first coordinate of x. You will pick all coordinates of x randomly. Mm-hmm. So you can think of ut as a coordinate of this vector u. And so you have to pick all the coordinates.
Okay. So it's okay. Not, at that stage, I guess it's not, you're not wondering about time steps.
Right.
It's just an index of it.
Yes, okay. Yes. Now, the other question that you raised was, how do you pick u0? Well, not u0, but the initial vector u. So sometimes you, of course, will have to go with random guesses, but sometimes you might have some domain knowledge, and you can use that to initialize your u. So this is particularly useful in space, the trajectory optimization of rockets that go into space. So of course, people who have been trained in astrophysics and who have done this for several years, they kind of know which trajectory to take, and then they want to fine-tune the trajectory using this optimization. So, yeah. In fact, if you want to get to Mars purely on the basis of this optimal control with random initialization, it will probably take millions, not millions, several hundreds of years for you to get to Mars. But if you call an astrophysics person who has studied physics and studied celestial objects, what he will suggest is, here is what we need to do. We need to put this spacecraft in orbit around the Earth. Then we need to get it into the orbit around the Moon. And then what you get is a slingshot effect. So the velocity of the vehicle is equal to the velocity of the vehicle, the initial velocity of the vehicle plus the velocity of the Moon. So you get the velocity of the Moon as part of the velocity of the vehicle. So you get an initial boost without actually spending fuel. And then you go to Venus, okay, and that's like in the opposite direction. Okay, so you go to Venus and then you get the velocity of Venus for free, and then you go to Mars. Okay, and that's why there is a specific window in which you need to send the spacecraft. So you won't be able to get that kind of solution by using this optimization. Okay, so domain expertise would be needed there. Yes?
Well, isn't that also because you have a moving target at the end as well?
I don't think it is because of the moving target. Okay. It's because of the distance. So if you want to cover this much, like whatever, 15 billion kilometers in certain amount of time, like 7 years, you need to have a lot of velocity. And how do you get that velocity? It's through using the velocity of existing celestial objects in the space.
Is that how the rover got there?
Yes, that's exactly how the rover got there. You know, the Pathfinder and all that, Mars rovers. Okay. So anyway, so this is what the derivative of GT with respect to UT looks like. Okay, now you will notice that the computation of the state happens in forward time. The computation of co-state vector happens going backward in time. So you start with x naught, then you have this vector u. You feed that into your algorithm. You compute x1 all the way up to xt. Then you feed that into this recursion, and you get pt minus 1 all the way up to p1, right? So you find the co-state vectors backward in time, and then you get the derivative gradient of ut of j as gradient of ft evaluated at xt and ut multiplied by pt plus 1. Okay. Okay, so you compute the forward, you compute using the initial state and the control actions you have chosen, you compute the states, then you compute the co-state vector. So you can't truncate this at some xt and then start computing the co-state vectors, because you cannot. You need the final co-state vector in order for this recursion to work. So then you compute the co-state vectors, and then you go ahead and compute the gradient of your cost function with respect to ut, and then you can do gradient descent or whatever you want to do to optimize.
So when you write up x1 and then u, it will enable you to calculate x1 through xt.
Yes.
Are those functions of u, or are those initial values of x?
You will use this recursion to compute x1 and then x2 and then x3.
But it is that part of the iterative process, or?
It is part of the iterative process.
Okay.
Okay.
And then you use the results from there to update what u is.
Yes. And so then you update u. So let's say u bar 0, and then u bar 1 equals to gradient of u bar of j. U bar 0. Oh, there is an alpha term here. So then your gradient descent is going to look like u bar 0 or u bar 1 equals to u bar 0 minus alpha 0 gradient of u bar j of u bar 0. Okay, and you will keep doing this iteration again and again. So again, for this u1, you will get the trajectory, you will get the costate vector, compute the derivative, and then go through the gradient descent step again. You can pick alpha naught according to whatever is your favorite method. Okay? Yes?
Yeah. So I just confused. Initially, what information do we need? So initial position, initial state, and then?
Yes, so initial position, which is, let's say for the spacecraft, it's on Earth. And then u bar naught is the initial
action.
Yes, initial action. So how much thrust are you going to give to the vehicle at every point of time?
Yeah.
Okay, and then you keep, and then you have this dynamical equation. And based on that, you will compute all the state trajectory, and then you will compute the costate, and then you will update. Okay.
Yeah, so when we have the x naught, we can get the x1 through the transition function.
Yes.
With the,
but you still need this action, yeah.
You know. And are you, how can you get the x2?
Well, when I pick this vector u0, it's, so okay, so what is vector uk? So that is u0k, u1k, utk, u capital T minus 1k, right? So you have, so when I'm writing this, I'm specifying all the actions that I'm taking all the way up to time T minus 1. Okay. Now, in the context of training neural network, which is also a terminal cost problem, this algorithm is known as backpropagation algorithm. Okay, so this is the derivation of backpropagation algorithm that is used for training neural networks.
So if you use the iteration like this,
can you speak a little louder?
If you use the iteration like this,
yes. This one?
Yes.
Yeah, it does. So it is certainly a function of xt minus 1 and xt minus 2 and all that.
I mean, the previous iteration will affect the next iteration.
Yes.
And the previous action will also affect the next iteration.
Yes, yes.
But you said the state will not be affected to the future action.
Well, so once you go through this iteration, what you get is u0 star, u1 star, u2 star, all the way up to ut star, ut minus 1 star, right? So it doesn't have any state dependence. So what I'm telling you is, no matter what happens in the world, if you start with this x0, just blindly take u1 star, u2 star, u3 star, all the way up to u capital T minus 1 star, and you will have the minimum cost. Okay? So it is completely blind. I don't even have to observe the state. I just have to keep applying this action, and I will be optimal. Because it's a deterministic system, so it doesn't really matter if you observe the state or not. Okay. So strictly speaking, observing the state and using the state to act requires you to know the policy, optimal policy. And that's useful in stochastic system, but may not be as useful in deterministic system. But then 99.99% of the systems in the world are stochastic systems. So you should observe your state. Yes?
What would be a good example of a purely deterministic system that's non-trivial?
Oh, non-trivial?
Yes.
Oh.
What's a trivial one?
Okay, so a stochastic system in which the uncertainty is known for the next 5 seconds or 5 milliseconds or 5 microsecond becomes a deterministic system.
Okay.
Okay. So when you are driving car, so you kind of know that people will not collide into you immediately, right?
Okay.
They will take like 4 or 5 seconds if everyone is far apart.
So over the next instant.
Yes.
Becomes deterministic.
Yes. Okay. So then the next instant becomes deterministic.
Sorry, professor. I think I'm having notation problems here.
Okay.
So When you just say UT, is that the same as UT bar? Or?
No, this one?
Yeah.
No, this is just a specific
the UT. The elements of the current
action? Yes. Yeah, so your gradient of U of J of U is gradient of U0 of J of U gradient with respect to U1 of J of U.
So say in the state transition function, is that UT arrow?
You this one? Yes. Yes, so FT of XT and UT.
Oh, it's only the, okay.
Yeah. Yes.
If the state transition, if we have to calculate the whole trajectory.
Right.
In order to use that gradient descent
algorithm. Yes.
But the state transition system depends upon X and U.
Yes.
If we only have U naught, then how do we calculate?
So that's what I said. This is U vector naught, which means you have U0k, U1k, UTk, and U all the way to capital T
Are
minus
you
1k.
We're picking
the actions for the entire duration.
So we randomly pick, or put it as some heuristic,
yes.
Pick
yes.
actions for the entire
duration. That's right. That's right. Okay? Yes?
So if you calculate xt plus 1, and then you somehow add another xc plus 2.
Mm-hmm.
You have to redo the whole problem.
You mean this model was not correct and then you had to add another correction term to the model? Yes, then you have to go through the entire thing all over again. Okay, if the correction is substantial, then too bad. Okay. You should have done your modeling exercise better then. All right, so that's the terminal cost problem. Now we want to solve the problem with running cost. Okay, and how do we do that? So, now my J is G capital T plus summation of GT, T equals 0 to capital T minus 1. And I want to find an analogous expression for this particular case when we have running cost. So what's the idea? Well, I'm going to add another state which keeps track of the running cost. So yt plus gt xt ut. Okay, and y0 is equal to 0. Okay, what's the updated cost function for this particular system? So my J, let me call it tilde, of U is equal to G capital T XT plus Y capital T. So by carefully augmenting this state, I have transformed this problem, dynamic problem with running cost, into a problem with terminal cost. Okay? So I've added a new state, scalar state yt, and then it becomes the terminal cost problem. So I can apply this result there. So let me rewrite this entire set of expressions. So x tilde of t plus 1 equals xt plus 1 yt plus 1 equals f tilde of x tilde t and And this is given by ft, xt, ut, and yt plus gt, xt, ut. And I'm going to define my co-state vector p tilde t plus 1, or p tilde t equals pt and zt. So this is the co-state vector corresponding to xt, and the zt would be the co-state vector corresponding to yt. Okay, we'll find out what the values look like in a bit. I am going to erase . So what all things I need in order to compute the p tildes? Sorry.
So with how we wind up generating the ending in ut before we iterate, doesn't this effectively make the impact of adding the running cost not occur until we're generating the next increments? They're sort of separable problems, aren't they?
I don't quite understand your question. So your question is, I have augmented the state, I have added the running cost. Does that affect the gradient descent algorithm? Or?
Well, with how we had the steps written, and the first time anything gets entangled with the ZT terms for what we had generated in the previous problem is right when we're generating gradient of J, U, zero term. So they're almost separable up until the update point, aren't they?
So let's look at the expressions for update equation for PT, and we will get back to your question. Okay, so let me compute this. So this is my G tilde T. So this is my G tilde X tilde capital T. So my P capital T equals to P capital T and Z capital T is given by gradient of G tilde of X tilde T. And what is that equal to? It's gradient of G capital T X T and then 1.
Sorry, Professor, what's the subscript of the gradient?
This is gradient with respect to x tilde t. Okay, so that's this term. Let's compute. Okay, so this is clear. Any questions? So now we need to compute the gradient of xt of f tilde t. So this is a matrix gradient of xt ft, gradient of yt, ft, gradient of xt, yt plus gt, and gradient of yt, yt plus gt. Okay? Do these terms simplify?
LF doesn't have any dependence on Y, correct?
Excuse me? Yeah.
Defined there at least, F does not have any dependence on Y.
That's right. So FT doesn't depend on YT, and YT doesn't depend on XT. So those two terms will be equal to 0. So I'll have gradient of XT FT 0, gradient of XT GT, and then 1. And I need more space. So okay, any question here? Okay, pretty straightforward. So derivative of the first term here with respect to xt and yt, and then the derivative of the second term in f tilde t, this part, with respect to xt and yt, so I get this expression. So this part is clear. So I computed this, I computed this. I now need to compute this part, which is gradient of ut with respect to f tilde, gradient of ut of f tilde t. So let me just write down the expression directly. That's gradient of ut of ft and gradient of ut of GT. Okay? Again, YT doesn't depend on UT. So the derivative with respect to UT is 0. Okay? Any question?
What has AT?
Sorry?
ZT?
Yeah. So we know Z capital T is equal to 1, okay? Let me compute what ZT is for every point of time. I have to use this expression to compute ZT, okay? So I'm going to erase this part. Okay. So I have PT equals to gradient XT FT, gradient XT GT 0, 1, PT plus, well, PT plus 1, wait a second, and then ZT plus 1. So this recursion gives that ZT equals to ZT plus 1 for all T, which implies ZT equals to 1 for all T. Moreover, I have PT equals gradient of XT FT plus multiplied by PT plus 1 plus gradient of XT GT. So I get the update expression for PT here. Okay, so this is just matrix multiplication. And then I have gradient of UT of G tilde T, X tilde T. That's gradient of, that's this multiplied by P tilde T plus 1. So that's given by gradient of ut ft pt plus 1 plus okay, this is another expression. Okay. Okay, so everything is clear so far. It's all matrix multiplication. Once we recognize that the state space equation can be rewritten in order to conform to this particular expression or the assumption that leads us to this expression, then we can just augment the state space, follow the mechanical rules, chain rule, differentiation and all that in order to get the update equation for the PT and the update equation for the gradient. Now, one thing you will notice is we are seeing this expression here, which is ft multiplied by pt plus 1 plus gt, differentiation with respect to xt here, and we have the same expression, derivative of ft multiplied by pt plus 1 plus gt with respect to ut. So we will give it a special name called Hamiltonian, okay, and I'm going to erase this part. So I'm going to define my Hamiltonian HT, which depends on XT, UT, and PT plus 1 as PT plus 1 transpose FT plus GT. Okay, this is known as Hamiltonian. And then my PT is an okay, so this leads us to, this whole analysis leads us to maximum principle, which basically says that if u star is optimal, you can compute all the xt's and all the pt's, and then the derivative with respect to ut of the Hamiltonian is going to be equal to zero for all time. Okay, so that's one version of maximum principle or minimum principle. Depending upon which book you refer to, for discrete time system. So we'll talk a little bit more about it and the properties of optimal solution in the next class, because it seems like the time is up. Okay? So again, we'll meet in the next class and we'll discuss the Hamiltonian and what does this optimal solution mean in the next class.